أفلا يتدبرون القرآن
ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهديه الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد. أما بعد، welcome to another episode of Quran in depth. And inshallah ta'ala, tonight we'll discuss the beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah. We have explained Surah Al-Fatiha, the most virtuous surah in the Quran. And now inshallah ta'ala, we're about to start the longest surah, the longest chapter in the Quran. We have talked about the tafsir of Surah Al-Baqarah in a different program. But in this program inshallah ta'ala, I would like to shed some lights and to go more in depth into some of the meanings that we need as Muslims to hold fast to and to apply the Book of Allah, the Quran, in every aspect of our life. And this is the purpose of this program, is how can we live the Quran? So we focus more into the practicality of what we learn. We need to learn how to recite the Quran. We need to ponder over its meaning. And we need to act according to the Quran. So for each and every one of us, if you have some deficiency in the way that you recite the Quran, this is the time to find a circle in a masjid or get a teacher or something. Even a person can listen to a tape in which we need to spend the time to be able to recite the Quran in the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed it to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And this is an act of worship that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala likes from His slaves, that they would spend the effort and the time and the wealth to be able to recite the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the same manner that it was revealed to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and that it was transferred from one generation to the other. So this is something that we need to take it upon ourselves. It doesn't matter how old or young we are, we need to take the time and to put the effort in which we will be able to recite the Quran in the most perfect way. And I don't need to remind you, we already had mentioned it before, many of the hadiths of the Prophet ﷺ that talks about this virtuousness of reciting the Quran. And one of which that the Prophet ﷺ said in the authentic hadith, Al-Mahiru bil-Quran ma'a safarati al-kiram al-barara, that the one that recites the Quran in a perfect way, he is among or will be among the scribes, the angels, in a very high level. Why? Because he recites the Quran in a perfect way. And the one that recites the Quran and it's difficult on him or her, and he is stuttering while he is reciting the Quran because he's still in the process of learning it, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said lahu ajran, that he would have two rewards, one reward for the recitation and one reward for the effort that we put while reciting the Quran. So this is an act of worship. So it doesn't matter whether the person is young or old. We tend to teach the Quran only to the little kids. But we need to take it upon ourselves, all of us, that we recite the Qur'an, that we perfect the recitation of the Qur'an. And if the moment of death comes to the person while he is in that process, as we heard before, النية أبلغ من العمل, that the intentions goes far beyond our actions. So this is something that we need to take seriously, something to be done, whether it's once a day, twice a week, whatever there is, that we take it upon ourselves that somebody is teaching us how to recite the Qur'an. And the second thing is that we need to ponder over the meanings of the Qur'an. And this pondering over the meanings of the Qur'an, something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Qur'an and ordered us to do that. كِتَابٌ أَنزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ ليتدبروا آياته وليتذكر أولو الألباب. That this is a blessed book. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed for what purpose? ليتدبروا آياته. For them to ponder over its verses. And for those who have sound minds, that they would have the proper reminder as a result of pondering over the verses of the Qur'an. So pondering over the verses of the Qur'an, this is our job that we're doing here in this program, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the understanding and the sincerity and to accept our deeds. So we need to understand, and understanding the Qur'an with the intentions that we are going to apply what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us. So that we would rejoice as a result of the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, their happiness and their rejoicing when the verses of the Qur'an would be revealed is far more than anything else on the face of earth. They used to enjoy the Qur'an so much, and we need to reach this level in which we would enjoy the Qur'an, but we need to put the effort. That the main concern in our life is the Qur'an. This is the most beautiful thing. This is the miraculous words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the thing between us and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how can then the Muslim, after knowing this and after knowing the virtues of the Qur'an, from the Qur'an and from the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we will be busy with many other things in our life and not the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Busy with it, reciting it, ponder over its meanings, and making the night prayer, reciting the Qur'an, memorizing, seeking cure, physical cure from the Qur'an, and cure to our hearts and the diseases of the hearts, and things like that, till the moment of death comes, when the person's life is all about the Qur'an, the same way as the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, this is the most joyful thing in their life, is the verses of Allah in the Qur'an. قُلْ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ وَبِرَحْمَتِهِ فَبِذَلِكَ فَلْيَفْرَحُوا هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِمَّا يَجْمَعُونَ. That by the bounty of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His mercy, then this is what they need to rejoice about. This is the Qur'an and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are the means for rejoicing and happiness for the Muslim in this life, and it's an extended happiness that is never terminated, because after this life it's the everlasting happiness as a result of holding fast to the Qur'an. When we see the life of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the companions radiallahu anhum, and how the Qur'an was everything in their life, then we need to imitate them in the same manner. And we need to seek the patience from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for us to be steadfast in the same way they were steadfast on. When, for example, you would hear in some of the traditions that a companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would stand the whole night repeating one verse, how much effect this verse of the Qur'an had in their hearts, that they would repeat it over and over again. This is something that has been reported from Aisha radiallahu anha, something that has been reported from Asma radiallahu anha, and many of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Like, for example, it was mentioned that Asma radiallahu anha, she was reciting in the Qur'an, in Surah At-Tur, verse number 27, فَمَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا وَوَقَانَ عَذَابَ السَّمُومِ. This verse that the people of Jannah, they would say in the Day of Judgment that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had bestowed His bounty unto them and shielded them and protected them from the severe punishment in the hellfire. So she would repeat this verse over and over again. The narrator of this incident, he heard Asma radiallahu anha reciting this over and over again, and he went to the market and he came back and he heard her reciting and repeating the same verse over and over again, weeping, pondering over the verse, making dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is how the Qur'an affected their life. When the verses was revealed, it was not just to someone else, it was for each and every one of them. The Qur'an was not just sent in general like that, but it was sent for every specific Muslim. Once a person says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, wa ashhadu anna Muhammadan Rasulullah, then the Qur'an is our life. The Qur'an is our honor and dignity. That the person spend the day and the night busy with the Qur'an to the best of our capacity. We do that in the 5 daily prayers. We do it as much as we can in the night prayer. We have the daily wird. And again, as I mentioned before, even if it's something small, few minutes, but every day we have to sit and open the Qur'an and recite from it. And we have another time in which we would sit and ponder over the verses of the Qur'an. We would have another time also in which we will try to memorize the Quran. Memorizing the Quran is something also recommended, yes, and it's something that we should not miss. Whether we are still young or old, we still should do something to gain this great reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And always a person would say, for example, I'm too old to memorize. We still can memorize a word a day. By being in the habit of memorizing, it's something that is definitely virtuous. And as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the authentic hadith, that one verse is a level in Jannah. And the person in the Day of Judgment will be said to the people of the Quran, recite the same way that you used to recite in the dunya, in the life of the world. And your level will be according to the last verse that you would recite. With every verse that a person memorized, it's a level in Jannah. And that's why some of the ulama, they said that the levels of Jannah, the number of the levels of Jannah is equal to the number of verses in the Quran. And I remember one time that a brother, and he was over 60 years old, and he was in the masjid. And I remember mentioning this hadith, and he did not memorize anything in the Quran, from the Quran. And he took it upon himself, and he was memorizing something very little every day. Maybe not even a verse a day. And I saw him after a year maybe or so, and he told me with very rejoicing face, and he was so happy, that he has been trying to memorize every day something, even if it's few words, but he has been consistently doing so. And he said that he memorized Surah Al-Baqarah. He had finished Surah Al-Baqarah. So it's never impossible. It's something that is feasible. But with the sincerity and seeking help from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, when a person is repeating the verses to memorize it, every letter, as we know, is equal to 10 rewards. So what is more virtuous and more valuable in our life than to hold fast to the Quran? And this is the mean for us to stay away from tribulations and fitan and things that are very confusing to many of the Muslims today. To be out of this, to be away from this, is to hold fast to the Quran by pondering over it. And of course, the Quran doesn't benefit us unless we hold fast to the Sunnah, to the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So again, in the beginning, I would like to encourage one another again to hold fast to the Quran, to spend the time reciting and memorizing and acting according to the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It would make the Muslim so much in contentment and so much happiness once we see that we are doing things according to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants from us, exactly like the same way the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we mentioned before how much effect they had in their hearts and their life when the verses of the Quran was revealed. How many times we recited the last three verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. And I mentioned this before, but again it's important to repeat these types of reminders. We recited the last three verses of Surah Al-Baqarah many times in our life. Why? Because it's one of the virtuous verses in the Quran. But these last two or three verses in Surah Al-Baqarah, when it was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they heard it, they rushed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they had so much concern, because in the verse Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَإِن تُبْدُوا مَا فِي أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ تُخْفُوهُ يُحَاسِبُكُمْ بِهِ اللَّهِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to Him belongs all that is in the heavens and all that is in the earth. And if you would show something or conceal it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will hold you accountable for it. So as a result of that, they went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and this is in Sahih Muslim and others. And they fell into their knees to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, and they said, O Prophet of Allah, we've been ordered to do things that is in our capacity. We've been ordered to establish the salah, to pay the zakat, to fight in the cause of Allah. And see, these things are in their capacity. And they submitted themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But they said, but this verse we're not able to apply. Meaning the whims that a person would have, it's something that is not in the control of the human being. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested them. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told them, don't be like the nations before. They used to say, we listen and we disobey. Say that we listen and we obey. And when they did that, the next verses was revealed, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala relieved this ummah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from such a burden. So as a result of that, and as a result of the barakah and the blessings of the submission of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that is not an obligation on us that we are held accountable with the whims that and the whispers that comes into our mind, and this is by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only the things that are being outspoken or the things that we do. But the point, the reason I mention this hadith and this incident is how the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they dealt with the verses. They didn't just seek the rewards from reciting the verse like many of us do today. Our goal is just to finish the Qur'an in recitation so that we gain so much rewards by every letter, thinking that we are free and in not much need to ponder over the verses of the Qur'an, that we are, mashallah, very perfect in our life, that we just need the rewards from recitation. They interacted with the verses of the Qur'an, that they would make sure that every verse in the Qur'an, that they applied it in the best of their capacity, and they were obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So how can we bring this attitude in our life? How can we relate every verse in the Qur'an to our life and our speech and our actions and our families and so on? This is the way that we would gain the levels and to gain the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And once we finish the Qur'an, then the more we recite the Qur'an, the more these meanings come into our lives and the more we are steadfast, because we tend to forget. This is the nature of the human beings. So that's why we need the reminders. We need to constantly recite the Qur'an with this intention to be able to ponder over the verses of the Qur'an. This is a long introduction to Surah Al-Baqarah, but we're about, inshallah ta'ala, to start with the longest surah, such a virtuous surah, Surah Al-Baqarah. Inshallah, after the break, we'll start with the first two verses of Surah Al-Baqarah. Stay, inshallah ta'ala, till we come back.
So this is an open invitation for everybody to recognize God and enjoy His blessings in this life and His mercy in this life and in the hereafter as well. Allah, Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, each name has a meaning. Each name signifies a nature of Allah the Almighty which no one shares or is compared to Allah in it.
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنَ.
الحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. Welcome back. Surah Al-Baqarah, the longest surah of the Quran. Such a virtuous surah, the same way as all the surahs and the chapters of the Quran. Surah that was revealed in Al-Madinah after the migration of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. There are quite a few hadiths where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam mentioned Surah Al-Baqarah and the importance of Surah Al-Baqarah, one of which the authentic hadith reported by Imam Muslim and others, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam ordered us to recite Surah Al-Baqarah. اقرأوا Surah Al-Baqarah. Recite Surah Al-Baqarah. So this is by itself brings the feel in the hearts of the Muslim that this is our Prophet, our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is ordering us as if he is standing in front of us, ordering us. And he used to have the mercy towards his followers alayhi salatu wasalam, that nothing that would get them closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless he ordered them to do. And nothing that would get the people away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala unless the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam warned us from it. He was sent as a mercy to all mankind. وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, that we did not send you except to be a mercy to all mankind. And this is the means of mercy. We have to feel that need to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Who would inform us about the virtues of Surah Al-Baqarah? It's not something that we get to know in the dreams or someone would see something. This is from the beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, something revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why this feel that we are in need of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is essential in the life of a Muslim. We get to know from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and from the perfect wahy, from the perfect and protected revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that this is something we do. So we make sure that when we are reciting it, we're not in doubt whether we are receiving rewards or not. We are sure that this is something that is so virtuous, and then we reflect upon ourselves to do it with sincerity and to follow the way of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So he said alayhi salatu wasalam, اقرأوا Surah Al-Baqarah, recite Surah Al-Baqarah, فَإِنَّ أَخْذَهَا بَرَكَةً, that recite Surah Al-Baqarah, because whoever takes Surah Al-Baqarah, whether it's reciting, memorizing, adopt Surah Al-Baqarah is a blessing. Baraka meaning that you have khair, that you have goodness that is never terminated. Goodness that stays with you. How many times people receive so much goodness, but then it goes away, or it does not have the baraka and the blessings in it. So the person won't stay for a long time with this goodness that he received and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestowed unto him. So for a person to receive the barakah and the blessings, the Prophet ﷺ said, recite Surah Al-Baqarah. For those who recite Surah Al-Baqarah, it's barakah for them. It's blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those who recite it. And he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, وَتَرْكُهَا حَسْرَةً, that whoever abandons Surah Al-Baqarah, does not recite Surah Al-Baqarah, it's a source of regret. And of course this regret is levels. For the disbelievers, they have the ultimate regret. And they will be in the hellfire forever. And they would regret, of course, that they were not among the believers. And also they would regret that in this life they did not worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They did not pray. They did not give the charity. They did not recite Surah Al-Baqarah, although kufr and disbelief is the worst crime, that nothing after that is equal to such a major crime. So the Prophet ﷺ said, recite Surah Al-Baqarah. For those who take Surah Al-Baqarah and recites it and act according to it, its barakah, its blessings. And for those who abandon or stay away from reciting Surah Al-Baqarah, it's a form of regret. And even if a person dies in the state of Al-Islam, wasting our life without reciting and pondering over the verses of the Qur'an, and one of which Surah Al-Baqarah, it will be a source of regret. So this is the time, this is it. While the person is still alive, to take advantage of these moments and seconds in our life so that we can gain as much rewards as we can. So the Prophet ﷺ said, whoever leaves it, it's hasra, it's a form and a source of regret. وَلَا تَسْتَطِيعُهَا الْبَطَلَ, that means that the magicians, the sorcerers, are not able to sustain or to oppose Surah Al-Baqarah. That means it's a way of protection from those who would commit such a major crime of black magic and so on. To protect yourself, recite Surah Al-Baqarah. And this is something also that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in another authentic hadith, that the house that the Surah Al-Baqarah is recited in, that the devils, they run away from it. They don't stay in a house where Surah Al-Baqarah is recited in that particular house. So the Prophet ﷺ said, Al-Bayt. That means what? That means our acts of worship is not just in the masajid, in the houses of Allah. It's also in our houses. Our homes should be filled with the recitation of the Qur'an, with the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The men, they go to the masajid to establish the salah in the houses of Allah. The women, they make their salah and they read their salah in their homes. And there's no harm if they go to the masjid, but with the proper conditions. And if the man is making the salah in the masjid, it doesn't mean that he abandons the acts of worship at home. The nawafil, the optional acts of worship, it's something that is recommended, and it's the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ to pray the sunnah prayer at home, as he used to do, alayhi salatu wasalam, to pray the night prayer, to recite the Qur'an. The sister of Imam Malik, rahimahullah, when she was asked what was the thing that Imam Malik was busy with during the day and during the night, she said, al-mushaf wa tilawa, that he was busy with the mushaf, with the Qur'an, and reciting the Qur'an. The same thing was mentioned about Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, and many of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Some of them even would refuse to leave the house till he finishes the portion of the Quran that he's supposed to recite every day. So this was part of their life. Surah Al-Baqarah, it's a long surah, yes, but we need to take the time out so that we recited it. In another authentic hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said that whoever recites Surah Al-Baqarah, that the shayateen won't enter the house for 3 days. The shayateen, the devils, won't enter such a house for 3 days. And this is something that can be collectively done in the household. Each person would recite a portion of Surah Al-Baqarah. And this is something that would bring the family together. Something that they would help one another in matters of goodness, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us. Many verses or many a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that talks about the virtues of Surah Al-Baqarah, and that it comes in the Day of Judgment to defend the owner of Surah Al-Baqarah. The one that used to recite and act and memorize Surah Al-Baqarah, Surah Al-Baqarah and Ali Imran will come in the Day of Judgment defending such a person. Will come in the form of two clouds on top of the person defending him, interceding for him. And definitely this is a sign that this person will be saved by the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a result of taking care of the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in our life with reciting and memorizing and so on and so forth. And there are many hadith as we heard. The Sahaba radiallahu anhum, as it's reported in some of the traditions, they spend, or some of them, they spend a long time learning Surah Al-Baqarah, learning the meanings of it, acting according to Surah Al-Baqarah. As we heard before, that the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they used to take 10 verses at a time, reciting them, learning them, and acting according to them, and then they would go to the next 10 and so on and so forth. So they learned and they acted hand in hand. There was no gap between learning and acting. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhuma, it was narrated that he studied Surah Al-Baqarah in 8 years. In another narration, 12 years. And after he finished Surah Al-Baqarah, he slaughtered a camel as a way that he was very happy that he finished learning Surah Al-Baqarah. It doesn't mean that we have to follow the same way, but it means that they used to take the time to ponder over Surah Al-Baqarah. It doesn't mean that he deprived himself from the meanings of Surah Al-Baqarah throughout these years, because they used to recite much of the Qur'an, and we need constantly to be in a state of learning. This is how to protect our faith and to protect our iman. So Surah Al-Baqarah, like any surah, any chapter in the Qur'an, starts with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. And as we mentioned before reciting the Qur'an, we say A'udhu Billahi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim, or A'udhu Billahi Al-Sami' Al-Alimi Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim, or A'udhu Billahi Al-Sami' Al-Alim Minash Shaitan Ar-Rajim Min Hamzi Wa Nafkhi Wa Nafthi. Then we say Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim is a separate verse that every chapter of the Qur'an starts with Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, except Surah Bara'ah, Surah At-Tawbah. Surah Al-Baqarah, again you would see Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, but there's no number of the verse, there's no number one, because it's a separate verse, not a verse of Surah Al-Baqarah. We talked about Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim being a verse in Surah Al-Fatiha, but for Surah Al-Baqarah, it's a separate verse. And we talked about the explanation of Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Then the first verse in Surah Al-Baqarah is Alif Lam Mim. And if you are watching some of the programs of the Tajweed, this takes 6 counts each. Alif Lam Mim. And these letters are recited as letters. It's not recited as a word. We don't say Alam. We recite them as separate letters. And as you know, this is something that many verses or many surahs of the Qur'an starts with these letters. And if you read in the tafsir, there are many explanations to it. And we're not going to get into the details of the differences of opinions and the opinions of the ulama or what these letters are. But it's basically, you can sum these different of opinions into some opinions. One of which, that these letters have meanings. That these letters have meanings. And some of them would say that the meaning of it is names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the names of the surahs, and so on and so forth. Another opinion would say that these letters have meanings, but only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best what the meanings of it. But it's definitely having a meaning, but only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. It was not revealed to us the meaning of these letters. So this is a second opinion. A third opinion, that these letters has no meanings to it. It's just letters of the alphabets. And the reason I recited it like this, the reason we recited like Alif Lam Mim, although when you read in the Quran, you might recite it as Alam. But the reason why we recited like this, because the Quran was transferred from one generation to the other, not just in a book that people discovered after so many years and they start reading the Quran. This was something that is transferred from one generation to the other by listening to the Qur'an. And that's why when a person is memorizing the Qur'an, he goes to a sheikh or someone in which he would memorize the Qur'an and recite the Qur'an. And the sheikh will give him the ijazah after he finished the whole Qur'an, reciting it in the same perfect way that this sheikh or that teacher had recited it to his teacher. And so on and so forth, till the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the Qur'an. So when those people, those who would claim that they found some scripts of the Qur'an here or there, And they would say that there is some discrepancies. This is all false, of course, accusations. The Quran is the only book on the face of earth that stayed that much long on the face of earth with such an accuracy that every letter has been preserved. And the main place of preserving the Quran is not in the books. The main place of preserving the Quran is the hearts of the Muslims from one generation to the other. So this is how we recite Alif Lam Mim. So when you recite the Quran, it's exactly the same way that has been recited from one generation to the other. So some said that it does not have meanings, it's just letters, the Arabic letters of the alphabets. And some said that yes, these are letters of the alphabets, but the opinion is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best what are these letters are, or what are these letters means. So these four opinions are, or sums the different opinions among the ulama. And as many of the ulama, they say that the correct opinion, that these are letters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows knows best subhanahu wa ta'ala what these letters means. But these are letters that has no meanings, just letters that the Quran or the surah of the Quran starts with. But they talked about the wisdom behind these letters. And this is something like Shaykh Islam Taymiyyah and Ibn al-Qayyim and others, when they mentioned that the reason or the wisdom behind these letters is to show the challenge of the Quran, that these are miraculous in its nature, that the Quran is not made from letters that people never heard before, as we know that the Quran is a miracle in itself, because it's the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the challenge, as we would hear in Surah Al-Baqarah, inshallah ta'ala, that the human beings and the jinn and all that exists were challenged to bring the like of a surah of the Quran. And the smallest surah is Surah Al-Kawthar. Inna a'tainaka al-kawthar, fasalli li rabbika wanhar. Inna shani'aka huwa al-abtar. Only three verses. And the challenge was given to even bring the like of that one surah. And no one is able to do that, and no one will be able to do that till the Day of Judgment, because it's the miraculous words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the point of the miracle of the Quran, that it was not revealed with letters that the human beings never heard before, otherwise it's not a miracle. The miraculous nature of the Quran, that the letters of these words are letters that are used in the Arabic language, not something that is from outer space. So that's why these letters, Alif, Lam, Mim, three letters from the Arabic language, to have the attention of the human beings that this is where the Quran is made of letters from the Arabic language, and the challenge is bring the like of the Quran, and people are not able to do so. So this is some of the meanings that has been mentioned. And the beauty of this, and this is a practical part of this one verse that has only three letters, Alif, Lam, Mim, the beauty of it is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the authentic hadith, the hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha, that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whoever recites a letter of the Quran, he will be given 10 rewards, because each letter is a reward, and each reward is multiplied by 10. And then he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, la aqul alif lam mim harf, walakin alifun harf, walamun harf, wa mimun harf. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I do not say that alif lam mim is one letter, but alif is one letter, lam is another letter, and mim is a third letter. So by just saying Alif Lam Mim, how long would that take? The person would receive 30 rewards. Each reward is better than this whole world and whatever it contains. And this is the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is how we need to recite the Quran and not to skip any verses of the Quran, because every letter is equal to 10 rewards, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. The next verse, inshallah, we'll discuss it after the break. Till then, we'll see you inshallah in a very few minutes, inshallah.
Who should you marry? When is it time for divorce? I want my children to love Islam, but I don't know how. The Quran and Sunnah has the answer to these questions and more. To find out what those answers are, check out Family Issues, and see the difference clear guidance makes.
Alhamdulillah, as-salatu was-salamu ala Rasulullah. Welcome back. The next verse of Surah Al-Baqarah, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, which means that this is the book with no doubt, in it is guidance for those who are al-muttaqeen. First, when it comes to reciting this verse, ذَلِكَ, and of course make sure that the tongue is out when we say ذلك, not ذلك, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه. Some of the ulama, they say that we stop at this word, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه, هدى للمتقين, or some stop, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. And both are correct, and it enriches the meaning of the verse. ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه, this book, there is no doubt in it. هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, guidance to those who are المتقين. And the next or the second meaning, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبُ, this book, there is no doubt, فِيهِ هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, in it, there is guidance to those who are المتقين. Both, of course, are correct. This verse, as we heard, means this book. And linguistically, in the Arabic language, the word ذَلِكَ, which is اسم إشارة للبعيد, meaning that if you want to call someone from far away distance, or you would point it to someone, if you want to point to someone from far away, you would say ذلك. But if you point to something that is close, you would say هذا. So this is, as the ulama of the tafsir, they say, to show that the book of Allah, the Quran, is so much honored. That shows that it's something that is in a high level. ذلك الكتاب, that this is the book, al-kitab, this is the book, لا ريب فيه, there is no doubt in it whatsoever. Why? Because it's all the truth from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the word ريب means doubt, but doubt with so much uncomfort and so much tribulation that inside of the person. And the Quran is free from all of that. The Quran that the believers, they believe in the certain, with certainty, in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No doubt about that the Quran is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that it has this miraculous nature in its linguistics, in the information that is there, in the orders from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in all aspects, whether it's the belief or acts of worship or mannerism, or you can name it, anything that is mentioned in the Quran is a miracle in itself. So the verse says, ذَلِكَ الْكِتَابُ لَا رَيْبَ فِيهِ, that this is the book in which there is no doubt in it. And when this is something that has been denied, meaning that the Quran has no doubt, in a context of praising it, that means it's the opposite of that meaning, brings the perfectness of the meaning of the verse, meaning that this Quran definitely with certainty is the book of truth. هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, or فِيهِ هُدَى لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, that in this book, guidance to those who have taqwa, or to those who are al-muttaqeen. We talked about guidance in Surah Al-Fatiha, when we mentioned that the most important and the most virtuous dua is to say, اهدنا الصلاة المستقيم, that we say, O Allah, guide us to the straight path. So guidance, as we heard before, it's the most important need in our life, is to be guided. Why? Because we're created to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. And if a person is not guided, that means he is misguided. He is deviated. And if a person is deviated, then the end path of such a deviation is hellfire. وَالْعِيَذُ بِاللَّهِ, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. And also if a Muslim is misguided with the words that he says or the actions that he do, that means he subject himself or herself to the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we are constantly in need of the guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So where can we seek this guidance? If we were truthful in Surah Al-Fatiha, when we made this dua sincerely to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, asking Him subhanahu wa ta'ala alone to guide us to the straight path, this is the straight path, which is the Quran. And this is something that is mentioned in one of the authentic hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, and we mentioned it before, where the Prophet ﷺ, as he said, that Allah gave the parable or the example of a sirat, a straight path, and there are two walls on both sides of the sirat, and in the two walls there are open doors, and on the open doors there is a curtain covering the doors, and there is someone that is calling people from the beginning of the sirat or the path, telling them, come on in and do not deviate. And there is a caller in the midst of the salat. And when the Prophet ﷺ explained this parable or this example, he said that the salat, the path, is al-Islam. And that the caller on top of the salat is the Qur'an. So the Qur'an is the one that is calling people to be steadfast on the deen of al-Islam. So there is no way for a person to be steadfast on the deen of al-Islam unless the Muslim would hold fast to the Qur'an and act according to the Qur'an. And the weakness and the deficiency in the steadfastness will be accordingly as a result of the weakness and the deficiency of holding fast to the Qur'an and acting according to the Qur'an. So this verse is teaching us and directing us that it's something that is upon ourselves, that we need to take every verse of the Qur'an as a way of guidance. It increases the guidance of the person, strengthening the guidance and the steadfastness on the deen of al-Islam, and any turning away, any deficiency in holding fast to the Qur'an, that would lead the person to some form of deviation. And that's why deviation is something that is inevitable among the Muslims in general. As a ummah, there is some deviance, yes. And this is the reality, as the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in some of the hadith. So how can we protect ourselves from some deviation? Is to hold fast to the Book of Allah, because in the Book of Allah is guidance to those who are al-muttaqeen. It shows also that those who have guidance are those who are al-muttaqeen. So we need to get to know who are the muttaqeen. Who are those people, those who are called to be the pious, the righteous, those who have the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and are obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. These are the guided ones. So the verse would immediately correct our understanding in things that we see in our life. Who are the guided ones? The guided ones are not the ones that have necessarily the more wealth or the high status in the society. The guided ones are those who are al-muttaqeen. And who would inform us about the muttaqeen? It's not something that people can get together and discuss, and they can figure out and come up with some characteristics of the righteous ones. If you ask anyone on any corner on the face of earth, they would have their own definition of those who are righteous. But people are in need of revelation from Allah. This is why we are in need of the revelation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because it's not left to the human beings to figure it out themselves. It is from the most merciful subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is the one subhanahu wa ta'ala that would inform us and teaches us who are the righteous one. We have a deficiency nowadays, and we need to face these problems that we as Muslims we fall into as a result of the absence in many cases, in many places, the absence of the clear and the correct knowledge. People would speak and act according to their desires and according to the ignorance as a result of not learning the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If we talk about the status of the Muslims nowadays and the calamities and the tribulations and the differences and so on and so forth, if you have any group of Muslims sitting together, you would find that everybody has the solution. Everybody think that they know what is these tribulations is for and what's the way out of it, and people would talk and discuss things. But many of us, mashallah, this is good. But many of us, we speak based on what we see around us. Some people, their source of information is the media. So they would hear the news, and then as a result they would analyze the news and they would draw conclusions, and they would act according to what they hear and what they see. And they would even order and advise and encourage one another to do certain acts of worship or whatnot. Based on what? Based on the news, for example, or based on somebody is speaking about something without having the credibility and the proper information. This is all ways of deviation that can make the Muslim easily drift away from the straight path of Sirat al-Mustaqim. How can we know the Sirat al-Mustaqim? How can we know the right path? What is right and what is wrong? Guidance for every word we say and every actions we do. This is something to be done only from the revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Qur'an, and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the ayah says, "Fihi hudan lilmuttaqin," that in the Quran is guidance to those who are al-muttaqin, guidance to all mankind, as it's mentioned in many verses in the Quran, because it has everything that the people need, and the special guidance that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bestow only to the believers, those who are chosen to be among the believers, something that is only from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is for those who are al-muttaqeen. So this is another great benefit that we learn, that in the Quran is the guidance, not somewhere else. And again, as we mentioned before, that the Quran and the Sunnah, they are hand in hand. So the guidance is in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Because how can we explain the Quran? We do not explain it based on our own desires, but we explain the Quran according to the way of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, according to the sayings and the actions of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and the early generations of Islam and the Arabic language and so on and so forth, as we talked about it before. And this is again the advice: if you go to some sessions of tafsir of the Quran, make sure that this is the way where the Quran is being explained, not explained according to what the situations of the people are, or according to the desires of the people, but according to the text, according to the Quran and the Sunnah, the authentic Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and in the way and the understanding and the speech of the companions of the Prophet ﷺ and the early generations of Al-Islam. So again, this is a great benefit that we learn from this verse, that the Quran has the guidance to those who have taqwa, to those who are Al-Muttaqeen. The word Al-Muttaqeen, these are the people, those who have taqwa. Taqwa is the action, and al-muttaqin are the people, those who have taqwa. Those who have taqwa, taqwa literally means that you have something that shields you from something harmful. That if a person is shielding himself from such evil, that means he is taking something as a way of taqwa, as a way of shielding oneself. So taqwa is basically a shield. As we know that we live in this life with so much different harms that comes to the person. And the biggest and the ultimate harm is when the person is thrown into the hellfire, the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a result of disbelief or sin or whatever there is. So as a result of that, we need to protect ourselves from evil. Any human being on the face of earth, any action or anything that they would say or do, it's based on two things: pushing away evil and harmful things, and bringing in anything that is benefiting. And this is the way of happiness in this life and in the hereafter. People do that, whether they are Muslims or non-Muslims. People act in this life to bring what is good and to push away what is evil. And the same thing for the believers. They protect themselves from disbelief, from shirk, from committing sins. They protect themselves from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the hellfire. And they bring what is good, which is the Jannah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the good things. So we live with both, and we have to make sure that we protect ourselves by pushing away the evil and adorning ourselves with what is good. So this is literally what al-muttaqeen, or the word taqwa, comes from. So what are these muttaqeen are shielding themselves from? What? Shielding themselves from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How would the believers, or how those who have taqwa, would shield themselves from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? They shield it by the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they run away from the punishment of Allah to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so vast. And whoever is sincere while fleeing to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most merciful. Shielding oneself, meaning this shield is made of what? Is made of doing the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us to do, and staying away from the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forbade us from doing. And this is taqwa. And this is the whole religion of Al-Islam. And as it's mentioned before, in which the ulama, they define the taqwa, but the beauty of the matter is that in the next verses, inshallah, we'll discuss it next time if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala explains the characteristics of those who have taqwa in this part of the surah, and throughout the Quran. So those who have taqwa, those who have the fear of Allah, obedient to Allah, stay away from the sins and disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, these are the guided ones. So it corrects our understanding, so that we would then understand what are these characteristics so that you are holding fast to it. The beginning of Surah Al-Baqarah, it classifies the people into three categories. The first category, those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are pleased with, and that is those who have taqwa, and we will see the characteristics of them. Then the next group are the disbelievers, and then the third group are the hypocrites. And these are the worst of all the groups. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will call all mankind to be among the first group. So now our duty is to get to know who are those who have taqwa, how to be among them, such an honor to be among those who have taqwa, how to be among them, what actions needs to be done for the person to have the characteristic of a taqwa, to receive the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is something inshallah ta'ala we'll discuss next time. And inshallah next time I would like to answer some of the questions that came to us through the email. So till next time, I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make the Qur'an our life, and the beauty of our life is according to the Qur'an, and to hold fast to the Qur'an and the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Wassalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
أَفَلَا يَتَدَبَّرُونَ الْقُرْآنِ ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيرا.
أفلا يتدبرون القرآن ولو كان من عند غير الله لوجدوا فيه اختلافا كثيراً.